This is Christopher with AG Productions. Welcome to another edition of Watch Me Work on Kiliox. I'm going to continue working on the legs, the feet, and this right hand here. I've got my highlight color mixed up. This is the first real highlight color. Everything up to now has been sort of shading and basing, but move into some highlights now. Need to add a little water to that. Sorry for the delay. It was a lot thicker than I had anticipated, but that's okay. We are ready and raring to go. Alright, I hope everybody out there in YouTube land is doing fantastically today. Having a great day here. Hoping it continues. Expecting it to continue. Any day where I get to sit down and work on some models is always a great day, you know? And even if I don't, just the fact that I woke up this morning, that's good enough for right now. Alright. Getting into the area where I kind of need to sort of define the knuckles a little bit, so I'm just going to sort of put some stripes on these knuckles. Not really going to do a whole lot of work with them, but where I am able to see some detail, I will kind of put it in. Don't know if you can see that or not, but just some teeny tiny little stripes right there. Okay. I'll continually be adding water to this paint mix because it is quite thick. Not 100% sure why. My highlight color is a little bit off. Not off in color, but off in consistency. And I probably should have highlighted those knuckles a little bit better, but I'll hit them next time. Okay. Let's start working into just sort of these top areas now. Now we've got a good base color established on most of this stuff. Let me come across the knuckles a little bit here. Like that. Okay, so I can tell just by looking at the back of that hand, it's a little bit too dark right there. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pick up a little bit of my previous color, that gold brown that I was working with in the last video, and add that in into some of the recesses right here, just a little bit, enough to kind of bring the color back, sort of back to life, get rid of some of these deep shadow areas. There we go. Okay. Sort of like that. Maybe we'll color up in here. Okay, that helps a lot. Now I don't have this gigantic dark mass at the top of the hand up there. So let me come in and redraw some of these lines over the fingers, over the finger bones. Outstanding. And then a little across the knuckles as well. And maybe even down here on the back side of this hand. Probably not going to be getting a whole lot of highlight down there, but I would like to touch it a little bit there. And then do the knuckles, just gently kind of dry brushing over them. There's no detail sculpted in on these knuckles up here for some reason. I don't want to differentiate again the fingers from the cracks between the fingers. The cracks between the fingers of this model are quite large, so you gotta work it to kind of make them look normal, I guess would be a good way to say it. But we're up to the challenge. It will prevail. And maybe just maybe a hair more over on that side over there. There we go. I'm gonna wipe my brush off and just kind of gently sort of pseudo dry brush down the rest of that finger. There we go. Perfect. Okay, so let me get a little more water. Alright, mix that into the paint just a little bit. And now let's work on the legs of the miniature, starting with the right leg here. Just go ahead and hit that area and then right here. And then this thigh area here. And guess what I was gonna spin the model around and paint the back side of the thigh, but I'll go ahead and do the front side down here. That way I don't have to spin the model as much. Save myself a little bit of work as far as model movement goes. It's not really gonna make much of a difference, but in the end it might save me, you know, 4 or 5 seconds every time I get to the foot area here. Just dipping my brush in some water. I want to make sure that you keep your paints properly moistened. They will they'll move around on the figure a lot more easily than a nice thick paint. Well, thick paint's good for dry brushing, but if you're doing any kind of actual painting, not really the best thing to have. There's certain techniques that you can use where thick paint works really well, even when you're painting, but it's not the go-to choice, not by a long shot. Okay. Do the ankle here, or the heel, I guess. We'll get to the ankle. Let's do it right now. There we go. Now we've done the ankle. This little spot right here as well. I think that would get a little bit of a highlight. Not much of one, just a bit. And maybe kind of the back here. Just a hint of highlight here and sort of feather that inside. Okay. Now I need to come up here and do the top of the calf. The almost impossible to get to top of the calf, which I, you know, I probably should have not put this gigantic weapon in place. But that would mean that the arm would not be on the miniature. Actually, I think the hand was the only thing that was attached here. Nope, I take that back. I can see some joint area there where I green stuffed in some stuff. So yes, this would have been very difficult to leave off until after painting with me having to do some green stuff work. So it's one of those things you gotta work around, I guess. Alright. Figure, just ballparking of course, but I figure with where we are right now, I think we've probably got 3 videos, maybe 4, including this one. I'm going to think probably 3 to finish up this short fur. And I'm not real sure where we're going to go after that. I think I might do some of the leather, just the little bits of leather. Not this big chunk up on top, but like all these little pieces sort of running around the padding and these straps and things like that. Just to kind of flesh out the model a little bit further, get a lot of these very similar details painted up and sort of dealt with. That way I don't have to look at empty white space anymore. But I don't know, we'll see. Haven't quite decided yet. Okay, there we go. And maybe a little paint right in there, a little up in there. A bit on that bone there, and some back here. Still need to repaint that hair on the back of his heel back there. I have not forgotten about that. I just need to finish up this area first. And then we'll do it. Okay, go ahead and touch the toe. Yeah, we're running about 10 minutes, and just judging on my palette from the last time I did this set of highlights, it took me about 4 highlights to get to a solid state color. the last time. In other words, a color straight out of the bottle. And then after that, it looks like just two highlights of our final color. So I suspect that if we do two highlights per video, and that seems to be where we are, at least right now, still highlighting a fair amount of the miniature. But in doing two highlights per video, that'll be about four videos, and we'll be done. I'd be excited about that, because this guy will have a ton of paint on him at that point, and we'll be in almost the home stretch. It'll be really, really nice looking. Looking forward to it, big time. Alright, this left foot is a lot easier to paint than the right foot. Just the orientation that it has to the sun, it just makes it so much easier. Okay, so I think we're basically good to go there. So let's add in a little bit more highlight color. Let me grab my bottle here. And this will be highlight number two out of what I think is four. Although I could speed things up, obviously, by adding a lot more color, or a lot more of the highlight color into the mix, but I'm not going to do that, I don't think. That's okay to do when you're moving from your shade into your base color. The highlight colors are something different. You've got to be very careful with them. If you get wild and wacky with your highlight colors, it can really mess a miniature up. I mean, big time. Looks so bizarre once you're done that nobody's going to want to look at it. And we don't want that. We want these things to be able to be enjoyed by people. Alright, back to the hand. And we'll just start right here. All I'm going to do this time is just start decreasing the amount of stuff that I hit with each of these highlights. This highlight is not going to be quite, as much as the last time, but I'm definitely not down to pinpoint highlighting, which is where I'll be when we, go, I don't know, about six highlights from now. I'll be down to just putting little dots on various parts of the model. I like getting to that point because the highlights go so quickly. I mean, just so super fast. Continuing to highlight each of these fingers all the way down to that secondary knuckle. And that's something I've always been curious about. I used to study magic as a kid, and even as an adult, honestly. But there was a great book written years and years and years and years and years ago, back in, I want to say, the late 1800s, maybe even, I don't know, maybe 1900s, early 1900s, I don't recall, but it's by a guy named J.B. Bobo, and there's a section in there where it's basically a book on coin magic, and there's a section in there where he's talking about placement of your fingers when working with coins, and he talks about the first, second, and third knuckles of the fingers. Well, what he never does is he never diagrams out, if I'm looking at my index finger, I've obviously got three knuckles, which one's the first one? And he never says, is this the first one, or is this the first one? This is always the second one, obviously. But which one is the first? Is it the knuckle that connects the finger to the hand, or is it the knuckle way out here on the front of the digit? And it's never explained in the book. It was so frustrating when I was a kid trying to figure out some of these sleight of hand techniques. And a lot of them I just sort of had to come up with my own variation because I could not tell what the guy was talking about. And one of the problems was he was never quite descriptive enough in saying what you needed to do with your fingers and describing where his descriptions were talking about. So that's probably one of the reasons that when I explain stuff, I'm very, very thorough. Because I want you guys to be able to replicate what I do. It's not just, hey, look at me, you know, I'm a cool painter, I can, you know, look at what I can do. Look what I can do! Stuart reference. I really want you guys to be able to duplicate this. Now, obviously, videos like this, much less teachy than an actual tutorial video. I've said that thousands of times, probably. Well, maybe hundreds. But the idea, you know, is if you're going to say, hey, let's make a tutorial, then make a tutorial that people understand. And not only that they understand, but they can duplicate. And, boy, this book, and I cannot remember what it was called. I want to say it was called Expert Coin Magic, but the name escapes me right now. I'd have to go over to my bookshelf and find it. I haven't looked at it in years. Moved on to other books, but Coin Manipulation, maybe? I don't recall, unfortunately. That's a shame. I should know what books I've read and what I haven't read. But anyway, you know, it's just one of those things to keep in mind, especially if you're thinking about doing a YouTube channel here. Whatever you're going to be doing, if you're going to be teaching something, make absolutely certain that you convey your message in such a way that people can understand what you're talking about, and can not only understand it, but replicate it. You know, I remember Brian Tracy, who's a great motivational speaker. I heard him one time say something very, very interesting. He said, the mark of a good teacher is not whether or not you communicate something well. He said, the mark of a good teacher is if you communicate something so well that the person you're communicating to can not only do what you're teaching them to do, but they can actually take that knowledge and then teach someone else. And I thought, wow, that is, you know, that's a heck of a challenge. Because, especially in this art stuff like the miniature painting world, you know, you can teach people what to do. It's not that difficult. I've got thousands of people that I've taught how to paint miniatures, and I've got people that can literally replicate what I do. I've had people send me pictures of their finished Let's Paint products after they've bought one of my Let's Paint DVDs, and they are so strikingly similar to what I have done in the DVD that it's almost impossible to tell the difference between their miniature and my miniature. And, like I said, you can teach people what to do, but being able to teach them in such a way that they can then turn around and teach someone else, that means you've got to really, really massively change how you present information, because you're presenting it so that it can be taught to someone else. You can't just show someone how to do something. You have to show them the whys and the, you know, the exact details of how to do something so well that they understand it enough they can then explain that. And that is, it's such a unique challenge, but it's a good challenge. It really is. I believe it's one every teacher should take on, because I think it's a fantastic challenge. But anyway, rambling here for a while, but we're at 19 minutes now, so I think what we'll do is we'll go ahead and cut the video. That second highlight was much quicker than the first, so we might actually knock out maybe 3 highlights in the next video if I'm real lucky. But for right now, we'll call it a day, and we'll come back next time and try to make some major progress on the legs and the hand here. And then, I don't know, we'll move on to something else after that. For right now, though, I want to thank you very much for watching. If you happen to have any comments or questions, please feel free to leave those in the comment section down below. Also, be sure to leave a thumbs up on this video and subscribe to AG Productions if you haven't done so already, so you don't miss any of these awesome videos. Again, thank you for watching. God bless you all. Have a fantastic rest of the day, and I will see you all in the next video.